Kuzazavu, and welcome to the final panel discussion of the GW. I guess the most important panel discussion, especially for the entrepreneurs. In this hour and a half discussion, panel discussion, we are going to discuss on the topic resource mobilization, in which we are going to discuss in detail about the access to finance, opportunities to mobilize resources, and the impediments that the entrepreneurs come across. Okay, now. So for this, I'm pleased to introduce to you my panel members, Dashokip Shusring, who is the current CEO of Bhutan National Bank. Dasho comes with a long experience in the banking sector and the credit culture in the country. And Dasho is also one of the prominent entrepreneurs himself, especially in the hotel industry. So thank you, Dasho, for your time. And on my left, as you know, I have Mr. Jirat Tati. Through him, I would like to get the international perspectives in terms of the resource mobilization opportunities, the best practices around the world. And also, Jirat has been himself an entrepreneur. He was running a pharmaceutical company, but now he sits on various boards on different international companies as an advisor and also as an investor himself. So he has been a venture capitalist. Today, Jirat is also the co-founder of Northern Entrepreneurship Program with Dr. Kamal Finzo, and he has been helping Northern Foundation. So Jirat comes with a huge experience of being an entrepreneur, being an investor, and also investor in the social sector. So I'm going to find out from him what attracts the investors to invest in the projects. And lastly, but not the least, I have Mr. Thachin, who you know, who you met already. Thachin is one of the promising, one of the emerging and dynamic entrepreneurs who started with a dairy farm. Today he runs a completely different firm. Today he runs a training institute called iBest. He is the founder and CEO of iBest Institute. But Thachin was also a journalist before he embarked on the journey of entrepreneurship. So welcome to this important discussion. Let me begin by asking a question to Dasho, because you have been in the banking sector for quite a while, for several years now. From my little interaction with the entrepreneurs and also during the previous panel discussions, I think entrepreneurs keep raising that while our banks in the country, while they provide credit, because most of these loans are collateral based, and also most of these loans are provided only to those who have reliable jobs. So from that perspective, entrepreneurs think that the loans are only for the fortunate ones, and the emerging entrepreneurs like them, the budding ones, the startups hardly get any opportunity. They do not get to enjoy the credit facilities that our banks provide. And we know there are a long range of credit facilities that our banks provide. So Dasho, if you could share with us if you have any special schemes that can help entrepreneurs, and you may have already started, so if you can share a little bit of your experience in terms of the credit facilities that you have launched through your banks in supporting entrepreneurs.
Thank you, Yogi. It's good to see there are a lot of participants this year. Regarding the subject, which is I think the resource mobilization, which is of course is very wide, but at the same time it is very scarce. So you know, the subject of what Doji has mentioned regarding the availability of credit to the startups, I think, which is in a way, yes, there are problems, but at the same time there are, I also do not agree that there is no credit to the startups. The banks and financial institutions since 1990, we started entrepreneurial development program. And it was initially this program was given at 100%. There was no capital equity contribution from your side. The entrepreneurs does not have to contribute. We're giving 100%. Even the equity was given free of interest for the 3 years. And we have the initial arrangement with the government was that the financial institutions will provide the credit to the entrepreneurs, and the government will provide the infrastructure facilities like land, road, electricity, all this are supposed to be provided by the government. So based on that, every year we had with the Ministry of Economic Affairs, we used to recruit two times programs are there. It was at least the 18-19 candidates were there all the time who came up with the projects, and they were giving training program for at least a month. And the resource people were either from the Ministry of Economic Affairs or sometimes even from the Asian Development Bank. So this had to continue till last few years back. And the result was, suppose it was not very encouraging. Although the financial institutions were given some sort of a quota to provide the credit to the entrepreneurs, but the projects that has come up are not really very encouraging. And at the same time, most of these are very small, and in terms of funding, it was not a problem. But the startups did not really have the experience of taking up those projects, because within 1 month training program, and then you have to come up with a project report, and then it was distributed among the financial institutions. And the result was that the loss, non-performing loss on those entrepreneurs were almost 70%. And currently it is around 40-45% loss on those. Of course, it was very small in terms of portfolio sizes. It was very small for the financial institutions. But we were willing to provide those. But then the government side, which the facilities like the road, electricity, land, which are supposed to be provided, it never came through. But nevertheless, we carried on. And it was with the Ministry of Economic Affairs, things were going on. And a couple of years back, they transferred that to the Ministry of Labor. And after it was taken over from the Ministry of Labor, it really didn't take off. So then they also came up with another scheme whereby the Ministry of Finance and the financial institutions has agreed that we provide the loan to the entrepreneurs up to a limit of 500,000. But that also, if there is a loss on the loan, the Ministry of Finance was supposed to bear 60% of the loan. And if there is the 40%, the financial institutions, we are willing to bear that. Even that one, when we claim for the 60%, when there was loss, the government never paid this back. So that's why the entrepreneurial development program never taken off. And recently I had taken up with the Financial Institutions Association meeting with the finance minister. We said that if you are willing to, from our side, we are still willing to carry on this, and we from our the support is always there, particularly in the micro and SME sector where we can finance. But the actual initiative has to come from the government. We are, of course, from our side, as such, resources available. And I don't think it is a big problem from the financial institution side. But if you come as an individual project, you want to start up a new project, I think sometimes it's very difficult. But if you have a very good project, I don't see there is a problem with it. Because we always finance projects. And what you said that collateral requirement is also not true, because collateral is always the business itself. We never ask anybody for additional collateral. Whatever is your project proposal, that's it. But you know, in case of if you are doing a trading business or you want to start a shop, that's where the problem comes, because we will ask for collateral, because what happens is the shop disappears overnight, and then you have stock. The stock disappears overnight, and then we cannot trace you. So there are problems in terms of giving such loans. But in many of the project based, whereas if you want to go with the manufacturing, it's not an issue. The issue is for you to find out land, you know, even appropriate place for setting up a business, which the government has to provide, because we can't do anything. But as such, even today I was, you know, I had a stock exchange board meeting today, and I have even suggested that the government is high time, the government should come up with a venture capital fund. So from the financial institution side, I have been pushing to the government as well as, to the central bank, that we should come up with a venture capital fund, which would be available for the startups like you. And financial institutions like us, we can participate in terms of providing the seed capital, or even participate as a venture capitalist. But we have a regulation that we cannot participate more than 20%. So in any venture that the bank provides, like, you know, as an equity participation or even venture capital, we cannot participate more than 20% of the particular firm. So if all the banks and financial institutions put together, we put some money also, I see that there is a possibility of coming up with a venture capital fund within Bhutan. But I think that has to be probably the Ministry of Economic Affairs or the government has to come up. But from our side, the willingness to participate and share our resources, it's not a big deal to get a few millions on such projects. But what is most important here today, what I see is that for many years I've been sitting in the Entrepreneurial Development Program meetings and came up many, many projects. But of course, there were a few people who have been very successful. They have done very well. But the majority of the fatalities are much more. You know, 60-70% goes on loss. And that probably is because of you're not having proper experience, or you're not having interest in your project, or many of the times your attention is not there on the project. So therefore, this is something which is, I think we need to cultivate the entrepreneurship program. The entrepreneurship is something which is, you have to come from within, your desire to do something. If you don't have a desire, just because you want to get it, do something in life, it may not be the point. The point is that you have a passion to do something. In any kind of a job that you do, if you have a passion, I'm sure you can be successful. But if you don't have passion, then you want to, okay, for the sake of living, you want to start up something. And then if you don't have the, you don't put your 100% effort in this, I think it's going to be devastating for you. But when you do a project, I think you have to be passionate about it. You have to be serious about it. You have to do proper study about it, and you have to willingness to sacrifice your time and effort, so that I think it is in Bhutan opportunities are there. Yes, in compared to other countries, we are a very small country. We have population size is small, the market size is small. Things are not very. Even if you have the resource and ideas, the market is small, but there are areas where you can do niche market. See, particularly in the agriculture sector, I see there is a huge potential for going into the niche markets of producing you know, the health food, related foods. There are so much, I think Bhutan has, you know, the, if you look at our temperature, you can see from a very hot to a very cold climate. So what can be produced anywhere in the world can be produced in Bhutan. Of course, it's not a large country where you can find big, but there is always an opportunity. There is always, you know, the ideas you have to come up with. And maybe you can, there are a lot of things you can do. But the problem is what I think we are somehow, as a society, we are very relaxed. We are not very serious about what we are doing. And you have to be passionate about what you're doing. If you are passionate, I'm sure, you know, anything that you do should be successful. But that goes with your effort and everything, you know. So my thinking is that please don't be discouraged by what I'm saying, that, you know, but ultimately it is you who is the entrepreneurs. Can be some of you today, you know, maybe, you know, startups, but maybe 15, 20 years time, you could be a very successful businessman. So opportunities are given. I think Lodin with the Gerard and friends, they have contributed so much money. I think Lodin is devoting their time for you. Please take it seriously. And from the financial institution side, I am the president of the Financial Institution Association. From my side, I have been trying my best to set up a fund, which is venture capital fund, which can be beneficial for the micro and SMEs, small, I think. And we also, Stock Exchange is going to come up with the you know, the SME sector, which can be totally taken care with proper attention. And there will be rules and regulations formed only for the SMEs. Currently, whether it's SME or manufacturing, big industries, we don't have any particular regulations or particular norms on what, and the government does not have particular attention on anything. But there has to be a focus on every sector. So if there's a SME division created within the government, Ministry of Economic Affairs or wherever, they will take care, make sure that things are taken care. But today, I think whatever government is doing their best in terms of providing employment or asking the organization to employ somebody, and we subsidize the government subsidy, giving money subsidy to the organization, I don't think that's another solution. The solution is we have to create ourselves wealth generation, and that is through effort and manufacturing. And you have to also in the agriculture, and maybe, of course, trading also is there. But trading is something which you, again, you know, it's some of you can be successful in trading. But the opportunities are there. So please, from our side, we will try our best. But don't have a notion that, okay, you cannot be successful because you don't have collateral. That is not the point. We will always do from the best from our side. Thank you.
Thank you, Tashu. I think that was very encouraging. I think Tashu proved, Tashu's statement, I think the situation seems to be otherwise than how we understood, because we always think that, you know, the facilities are only for the elite groups, the fortunate ones, those who have jobs and land and buildings to put as a collateral. But I think banks seem to have special schemes for the startups. And I think they seem to have started with a credit guarantee scheme. And it's very encouraging to hear from Tashu in your capacity as the CEO of Bhutan National Bank, and also in your capacity, especially as the president of Association of Bhutan Financial Institution, I think willing to invest in building, introducing more financial products. That's very encouraging, Tashu. Let me jump on to Tharchin. Tashu has sort of presented to us a sort of a rosy picture that, you know, they do have facilities, and, you know, if you are genuine and passionate about your projects, and if you have projects at hand, they do finance. I'm sure when you start your business, you must have gone around trying to mobilize resources, and you must have come across impediments. So if you were successful in raising funds, what sort of tactics did you use? I think that would be useful if you can share a bit of your experience to our audience here.
example, Karen. First of all, thank you to Lode Foundation, and thank you for having supported a very nice person back then in 2010. And then to begin with, as a person, more than funding, since like there are so many young people out here, I would like to give a true picture of how like business should be set up. Like, because as a person, like more as much as the fund is important, as much as the fund is so important to set up a business, but I would like to really thank Lothian for supporting me back then in 2010, because now I wish like I should have been supported back then in 2010. This is a different perspective. I'm talking to you, and then I don't want to become unpopular by telling all these things. But as a young person, like I wish I had not taken up this Lothian project, because I didn't have so much of resources that I thought was important to set up a business plan. Because that much any resource of the room, we might be thinking only about getting the funding to set up a business and all that. Now I want to take a little bit back. Whoever, as a young person who has a business idea, what they do is like they immediately looking for a funding model when they want to set up a business. But now I want all of you to reflect. Come on, what are the resources that are really needed to set up a business? Okay, and on a general, we know like we need people. Come on, we need people, a team of people to set up a business, and we will know for sure like in what kind of area the business that you want to do or like deliver your products or services. For that, you need your technical expertise, more than skills. And then after some time, then if you can go to a funding support lab, I think that will be very smart and wise on your part to do that. Before, you know, once the moment you have a business idea, if you jump directly to start looking for a fund, so you might have to go through a difficulties like that I have gone through, more than. So what I'm trying to say is like, the funding is very important. But as Dr. Kichu mentioned, like there are so many things which are happening with the financial institutions and setting up. From my side, I see it as an investment bank. If there is any investment bank in Bhutan, whereby like they could easily support the idea, which is very feasible and viable. So many things are happening at the national level, at the ministry level, and at the NGO level, and at the community level, at the personal level. Because at the NGO level, Lothian is championing the cause of promoting entrepreneurship. And at the ministry level, the Minister of Labour and Human Resources, especially the Office of EDP, Mula Development Program Office, they are jumping the course of talent, training the talent pool that is required. Mula. Now, as a person, what I would like to see is like the moment you have a business idea, please try to study what are the resources that you require. If as a person, if you feel like you really don't have entrepreneurship skills or entrepreneurial skills, please try to develop that. Mula. Please don't try to go everything that you want to do in a haste. When you don't think and then you act, then this is where the things become heavier. And then try to get the people that you require. But it is not like you go to a subject bazaar and then you pick up. So as a person, what you do is like, okay, if it is in terms of people that you want to get on the board, to help you support your business, I think you should be talking to so many people, especially the close ones. First, you start with your family and relatives. Okay, what these people can do for you? Some of them can be promoting your business in terms of doing a publicity for you. Some of them can be a brand ambassador for you. Some of them can really helping you to raise a fund, Mula, or by giving a strategic connection for you, Mula. And the second thing is now try to get into a close friends of circle, Mula. And your friends, like what kind of expertise they have, what kind of help or assistance they can give, and then go beyond. So you have to really talk to people. You talk to people, then find out, okay, information, kind of right person, kind of right expertise. So this can be looked as one element of resource, more or less. And second is, and then you look for a fund. The fund of the left, I would like to suggest you to be very smart on this level. Maybe you want to really passionate to do some service or product, but sometimes you have to weigh now the balance, okay? Now what is the Lothian objective, you know? What kind of Lothian does Lothian support the projects? 몰라 안 지금 성당 말고 because the funding support is there from Loden. Now as much as you want the funding from Loden, why don't you be smart enough to study Lodengi, Dazun to the support you in that? Mula. And there are so many funding opportunities. And then there are places like UNDP, ADB. Now what kind of projects they do support? If UNDP is supporting a project which are related to environment, Mula, if ADB is supporting a project which is related to online business, anything, Mula. And we have office called Department of Portage and Small Industry. What I found out was annually they support, they give a grant of 2 lakhs, 200,000. And then we as a person, like we talk to so many people, and then we hear the rumor in the market where people say like there are so many people in Bhutan who don't know what to do with the money. So literally what it means, like people have money. It's just that they need the person to come forward to them and then, you know, ask for the investment. So this is how I look at it when I talk about the resource mobilization.
Okay, thank you. Let me stop you there. I think Tachin is of the view that I think as an entrepreneur, I think you need to put time and effort in doing the necessary homework and research. As long as we believe in your idea, as long as we put together the right skills and the expertise, and in order to mobilize resources, I think it is important to also raise, understand, study the area of interest of the particular company that you intend to apply for the funds. So, Tarchin seems to believe more on your idea. As long as you have idea, then raising a fund should not be a problem. Now, Girard, as I shared in the introductory note, he was also an entrepreneur himself, and now as an investor. So, to you, from your experience, what is important to you? Is it to start a business? Is it the idea, or is it the financial assistance first? What is important? What is most important to you, and why do you think so?
Thank you. Thank you, Toby. Being squeezed between a national banker and a Loden entrepreneur, it would be rather stupid for me to comment too much about the situation in Bhutan. And I think that you asked me to be part of this panel to give you an international perspective.
Right.
And what can I, when I observe this type of very traditional debate between the financial institution who basically say any good project will one day be financed, and the entrepreneur who say we have a very big difficulty to access finance. I can tell you this is not a problem unique to Bhutan. I started 30 years ago as a venture capitalist. I think I was probably one of the very few Europeans who started the venture capital business. And I can give you an anecdote. I have two brothers who are entrepreneurs. And when I told them that I was going to create, with the support of a big bank, which was, in this case was Citibank, a venture capital firm in France, they believed for several years that this was not a real job. I mean, that it could not be a real job to be somewhere between the banks and the entrepreneur. And someday, the banks will take it back, as a normal role, and the entrepreneur would basically also maybe find their money from somewhere else. My brothers were pretty wrong, because today, the venture capital community in the US, but also in Europe, and now more and more in Asia, is a very big industry. It's, I would say, a fashionable industry. It's an industry where people want to go. So I mentioned that to say, and this is what I would like to bring to this debate, is that the world of finance is on the verge of a huge transformation. And I'm sure that if I am say enough to come back to the country in 10 years from now, the debate we have this evening will look a little out of date. One of the most important sectors for venture capitalists today is called fintech. The investment in new companies in finance, I checked before coming with my note, the investment in fintech has been multiplied by 4 between 2012 and 2015, and more than $12 billion are invested last year, have been invested in fintech. What is fintech? Fintech is a combination of this world, finance and technology. I think maybe it's the name are not that familiar to you, but what do we call fintech? What are the company? Lending Club, TransferWise, BinPay, Zopa. I mean, there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. There are many more now than there are of banks. But let's try to explain a little more what is fintech. Fintech is first, I've put, let's say, 6 categories of fintech in order for you maybe to understand better what I'm talking about. The first one is mobile payment. And mobile payment is, you know, the way that you, with your mobile, you are able to pay. Okay. This has been initiated, in fact, in developing countries. And my feeling is that developing countries are going to lead the fintech revolution. Why? Because they don't have the big banking infrastructure. In my town, in London, there is a bank every 6 stores, or maybe 10 stores, there is a bank. You know, in the high street Kensington, which is a street I know well, there are probably 6 banks, which are stores there. Okay. So there are thousands of banks. So you are never far from a bank. Okay. Mobile application have been developed in Kenya. Kenya has been with a company called M-Pesa, and now most of the payment in Kenya, which is not a small country, I don't know, 40 million people or something like that, are done by app. Okay. So mobile payment. The second point is equity funding, which includes venture capital, which includes which is basically investment. Investment in a company. Okay. Equity funding. In China, there are 1,500 platforms of equity funding online, which last year provided $250 million to the Chinese company. I've not compared with the big Chinese bank, but $250 million by any standard is a big money. And there is 1,500 platforms. There were 76 in 2012. Okay. Loans. Loans are done traditionally by banks. This is the job of a bank. You have a company which happened to be run by a Frenchman called Lending Club, which is providing loans peer-to-peer. So it's a company which is providing directly a loan to somebody else, or a person who is providing a loan entirely online. I don't imagine there is a store of Lending Club. Lending Club was quoted on New York Stock Exchange for the price of $5 billion, and I think it has some ups and downs, so it's not just, you know, everything that's going up, it has some ups and downs, but it's still worth probably $10 billion. The company was started in 2010. Fourth category, money transfer. One of the most annoying point of a citizen when I'm dealing with bank is how long it takes to transfer some money, for example, between France and the UK. It's unbelievable. It takes 2 days and a half, which is probably the same number of days that it took 20 years ago. 2 days and a half to move £10,000 into €10,000, unbelievable. But that's the fact, and I'm using some of the good banks, you know, Barclays, BNP, and all that. Now, I never use a bank to do any money transfer. Finish. I'm using a new company called TransferWise. I do it online, They are a ceiling, so I cannot move, I would say, big amount, but I think for ceiling maybe 6,000 pounds or something like that. I do it online. I use sometimes my bank card for some reason, but I can also use other technique, probably soon on my mobile phone. As soon as transfer, I receive an email telling me your money is on the way. Then 2 hours later, or 1 hour later, I receive the money is in France. Then 1 hour and 50, or I mean, let's say 2 hours after, I receive a message from the person to whom I'm giving this money saying your money has arrived. 2 hours compared to 2 days and a half. But the most important part is that they tell you, and this is very much on their advertising campaign, if you were using a bank, let's say you move, let's give an example, 1,000 euros, if you were using a bank, the bank would take on average 6 euros or 7 euros. With us, it's 1 euro. You are saving 5 euros. But, so you may say, how do they do that? That was the question I had in my mind. Okay, bank take large commission, but why a company is able to offer a service at a 20% of the cost of a bank? The reason is very, very smart. Why I'm transferring 1,000 euros from France to the UK, an Englishman is transferring 1,000 pounds from the UK to France. TransferWise knows it. So they balance it. So they never really transfer your money. They just transfer the balance. This is the only money on which they transform their pounds to euros. And as on average, there are probably as many Frenchmen who transfer their money to the UK than the UK will transfer to France. They are paying the normal trading fees, I imagine, to every bank, only maybe on 10% of the money. This is how they make the money. How it's possible? Entirely because it is online. Every minute, they know how much money goes one way, how much money goes the other way. This company, by the way, was started by two young people from a very small country, one of the smallest European countries called Estonia. And the company was started, I think, 5 years ago. Fifth theme, trading platform. A lot of people are trading. Again, trading, if you are trading anything online, you have a much, much better understanding of what is going in one direction on the other way. So the trading platform, if they are online, if they are new, have a huge advantage. And finally, there is a big theme right now that the insurance company, which is one of the most conservative industries in the world, you know, Lloyd's started 200 years ago and all that, is going to be transformed again through insurance. And rather than to go to an insurance company, you will insure between people. It's peer-to-peer insurance. So what I just wanted to say is that Bhutan, in a way, has a big chance. The chance is that the financial industry here has been created not that long ago. It is compared with other countries, you know, you don't have that many retail banks, you don't have. And I'm pretty sure that, I'm sure Dasho is thinking about it all the time. The banks are going to have to streamline a lot their activity. And the big advantage of fintech is what? Access to finance, because it opens a lot of new opportunities, and speed. I really think the most important thing is speed. In finance, you need to go fast, and this revolution of speed, I can tell you, is coming.
Thank you, Gerard. Thank you so much. Dasho, I would like to get back to you. You were mentioning about the credit guarantee scheme, which the banks launched in collaboration with the government, and with no success. And also it's very good to know that the bank is still willing to, you know, collaborate with the government. If they're willing, you're willing to relaunch the scheme, which would be very useful for the entrepreneurs. For the government, because the government keeps changing, and also with the development activities, their priority keeps changing. So they may say yes, they may not, but they may say no because of their own priorities. But as Dashu may agree, I think entrepreneurs are very important. I think research has clearly proven that it is the SMEs that make significant amount of contribution in supporting the economy. And likewise, I think same thing is happening here in Bhutan. So considering this, even if the government may not be interested in relaunching the SIM, in your capacity as the president and CEO of one of the private banks, would you be willing to still explore alternatives to relaunch in collaboration with other financial institutions in the country?
Thank you. I think I just like to tell you that the BNB as an organization, I tell you that we have a, I don't know whether there's one entrepreneur called in the Greenaway.
Yes, sir.
And he has been running post to Fumila and trying to get funding, and he did not get funding from anywhere else. He did not have a penny in his pocket. Start of the project. He went to DHI, he went to all the banks. He came to me. And I looked at his project. And I have financed him 100%. That was a startup project with his 10 million. That's a big money for Bhutan's context for a startup. And today, we have finance him up to 25 to 30 million, just 2.5 crores to three crores money. I don't have a figure here, but he is successfully running the project with no equity capital from his side. And we helped. I saw there was a good project. I saw that he is very eager to take up the project, and he had potential to take up the project. I took a chance. And giving a 10 million project in Bhutan, it is quite rare for a startup. But you can ask him who financed him. I did initially give him 10 million, and today he's successful. His loan is paid regularly. And with all that, last year he came up with another project to garbage collection. And he wanted another 10, 15 million. I get that, because he was successful. And through history, through one's record, I know that you can be a successful man. You are a good entrepreneur. But from the startup, if you are a startup, then you start to slack in your repayments, then I think you will not get your help from any financial institutions. But if your loan is up to date, you have a record of, you have to prove yourself, 3-4 years of record, you'll be able to break into the financial sector. I mean, you prove yourself. You have to prove yourself. Now, one way of proving is that, many ways, if you want to finance somebody without collateral or nothing, is also that I see there's a cash flow. And cash flow is, you can start maybe a pawn shop or maybe a shop, a grocery or a small shop. But if you prove yourself that you have a cash flow, you have enough money flowing in, the banks will, financial institutions will finance based on your collateral. But there are also on the supply side, there are many of the people who you want to supply, certain things to the government departments or so many of the agencies. But they also, you don't have money now. So you got a supply order, but you don't have money. But, the banks do finance, of course, on the supply side. If you are a proven track record, we will also finance you on your supplies. That means you have to have a good record with the bank. And establishing a record, good record with the bank, it takes time. Okay? But for a startup, you have to have a good project. Good project is like what Greenaway has done. You ask him, you know, how much we have BNB has done. And whatever he's today, everything is financed from BNB. He's paying loans on regular. He did not have a penny from his pocket to do the project. So similarly, you could have bright ideas, but I tell you, you know, there is, as a, you know, the for the startups and SMEs, the government has to think of something. There has to be some sort of regulation, some sort of attention from the government side, which will promote the SMEs. And that is when you have a regulation. Right now, as I told you, there's no regulation. The government does not have attention to the small business. We as a bank, you know, my bank is a commercial bank. We'll go for a bigger projects, bigger. We do have small units where you give you things, but me as a CEO, I cannot pay attention to every minor thing. I have to go for a bigger catch. My thing is to produce, you know, to we have to create profit for our investors. And at the same time, we have to also, you know, contribute to the exchequer. Now today, if you see it, I'm not bragging, but BNB is a successful case of an organization in Bhutan. There are so many organizations in Bhutan which has taken off. But today, if you look at BNB today is 19 years old plus. We started off with unit trust conversion from unit trust to the Bhutan National Bank. When we started off, when I took over, the bank was only 6 months old, and the non-performing loan was 37%. The number of employees are over 40, and total fund was 700 million, 70 crores. But today it is, we have 32 billion asset, and we are producing a profit of 1 billion. We are paying to the exchequer 44 crores as a profit. I'm giving my employees 6 months bonuses. But, you know, is this something which is, it doesn't come with, it has to be created with a lot of effort on the part of the management, my employees. And it is a case of a very successful organization which has been done extremely well. And if you look at in Bhutan, BNB started off with a capital of, is 5 crores. 5 crores capital in 1997. And today our capital is almost 7 billion. We have investments from IFC, we had investments from Citibank, I have investment from ADB. We are a successful case of an organization. Of course, I would like to promote the ADB as such. This is, is a part of my own aspiration that we want to start up the people who are unemployed, people who are eager to take up projects. This is my own passion also. But at the same time, I have to look after an organization which is big. I have to look for a bigger picture. So we don't have time. But what my personal suggestion to the, of course, it has to be the Ministry of Economic Affairs, the Royal Government of Bhutan has to come up with the SME, to take care of the SME problems, to give the SMEs, and provide them the necessary backup facilities. But unless these are there, you are running from pillar to post, and if you have maybe land, you have no water, you have the water, there's no electricity, and all this costs huge money. And by the time you put up this money into sink, all your money into that,
then you know, your project may not be taking off well. All your resources are spent on the infrastructure. But my suggestion is today is that the government has to create you know, the SME areas. Maybe come up with the industrial estates, which may be particularly geared towards the setting up the SMEs, where you don't have to go up here and there. You just come up with the idea and you come with the thing. The government infrastructure is already readily available. The government should provide that. If that is available, you go there. You don't have to spend on electricity. You don't have to spend on water. You don't have to spend on road. Everything should be laid by the government. You just come with the ideas and money up for the financial institutions will take care. But at the same time, you don't have equity. That is another consideration. So as I said, we have to come up with a venture capital. And otherwise also, I think the organizations, charitable organizations like Lodhen is giving free of interest. And with the free of you know, loan, without interest also, people are having difficult time to break in and make profit. Of course, there are successful cases. Many of them are successful. Even in entrepreneurs, also, few of them are successful. But not everybody is going to be successful. All what it is, the government has to make a, it is time, because there are a lot of youth like you all that who have the, you know, aspiration to come up with projects. But it is very important that you know, the things are available for you so that you go and start it. But if you have to run pillar to post today, as it is today, I think even the financial institutions have to think twice, because if I want to invest in you, firstly buying the land, then secondly, you know, putting up an electricity post in that, and thirdly, you have to make a road in that, that money is just gone, and then your project is not going to be gone. But if you have to have a project viable, the government has to lay the foundation for all you to, for you to take up the thing. But as a financial institution, we are willing to provide something which is the project proposal has to be sound. You know, as a banker, I will know if the moment you bring up a project, whether it's going to be successful, you know, the viable or not. If you come up with a project which is not going to be viable, we definitely will not support it. But there are 100 ways of getting resources. Maybe many of you have your own relatives who are willing to support you. Your parents maybe are willing to support you. Maybe, of course, the friends will be difficult. But there are NGOs like Lodhen and Tarayana, so many, smaller scale. But those are money is available. I think it is something which is, but it has to be thought at the government level. I tell you, because it is high time we set up a SME sector, where the funding can be done, where the you know, the your location, everything can be settled without much running about. So my suggestion is that we are willing to do, but we cannot do beyond when your project becomes unviable, as I said, you know, because of investment in the infrastructure. But you know, take my word, financial sector will always support. That is for. We need the support from the government to come up with a proper infrastructure. I believe you are meeting Prime Minister tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
So it is time that you bring it to the government notice that it is high time you come up with certain kind of, you know, who looks after the, look for the SME sector. And there must be some rules and regulations how the SME should be. And attention should be provided, you know, because the focus is what today they are doing is unemployment, but unemployment is not going to be solved by subsidizing you to, okay, you know, join this organization, we will pay you this much. That is not going to be, I tell you, this is something a waste of money. You want to do on a product sector, agriculture is one area, I tell you, there is enormous scope of making an agriculture sector. There's, you know, you don't have to go in a big way, but niche market, organic. This is something which is sellable, and the country has to market it properly. And India is the next door, market is available. You know, I personally do a lot of research in my own house. I mean, I just stay a few years from here. But I do a lot of agriculture research and see what can be done. I've been very successful in many ways. Many things can be produced in Bhutan without even, but commercially doing also is something different. You know, I don't have much time to take up until I retire. So right now, you know, I don't have much time to take up any commercial project, but I do a research on agricultural items, like goji berry is an organic item which is good for health. It is being, you know, sold in Chinese, have been selling the goji berry for last 4,000 years, 2,000 years or something. And it is being marketed in the West, Gerard and colleagues here will be knowing. In the West, it is sold. In Hong Kong, 250 grams of goji berry is being sold for 50 Hong Kong dollars in the retail market. But that is, you know, for 1 kg, if you sell organic, they were telling me the organic one is 3,000 Hong Kong dollars per kg. For us, we don't need $3,000. But it is $100, I mean, $1,000 also is a very big thing for Bhutan. So there are projects which can be, and I have done my own research and produced the goji berry, which is called, you know, the, in, I don't know in Bhutanese, but it has been a Himalayan fruit, the berry. But it has a lot of market. Similarly, you can produce fig. Similarly, you can do, you know, many, many things in Bhutan. But that is something which, you know, ideas you need to have the passion to take up. So from our side, please make sure that, you know, we will support, but things has to be in order, because right now the government has to come up with appropriate regulations or legislations where, you know, you support this.
Yes. Thank you, Tashu. That is very encouraging, especially looking at from where you started from 7 crores to, you know, progressing up to 7 billion. Company is a very amazing, outstanding performance. So would you like to give Tashu a round of applause for that? Tashu, I want to ask a quick follow-up question. Tashu was mentioning about while you would be interested to supporting businesses, but of course Tashu has also given enough hints for you. You know, any businesses within the agriculture sector, would you be, if you come up with this kind of process, I think the chances are quite high that Tashu might invest in these projects. But Tashu was also mentioning that things needs to be in proper shape. You need to prepare yourself, you need to come up with a business proposal. It should be financially viable and sustainable. And to come up to that level of education and to enhance the caliber of entrepreneurs to that level, I think it also takes a lot of resources in preparing them. For now, I think be it the financial institutions, be it the charitable organizations like Lothian Foundation, I sometimes feel that we are simply waiting for entrepreneurs to come and approach ourselves. But now I feel we have reached at a stage where we need to go beyond in creating the entrepreneurs, in giving them, you know, adequate skills, maybe as part of our social corporate responsibility, so that it's like building our own companies in the future. So Tashu, have you also thought through this line in terms of, you know, maybe enhancing their capacity so that they're able to submit to you a viable project so that as they become bigger, as they grow, I think they have more loans, and then that gives you a sort of win-win outcome for both the bank and also for the entrepreneurs. I'm not sure a precise answer to this.
Any, as I told you, you know, from the bank side, we will always support it. But the critical factor is for you to be successful. You know, you need that government policy which is in the right place. Government support. And today, without the government support, you are like, you know, we have, I tell you, we have people who are billionaires, they're coming project proposals to us almost every day. And you are a very small segment in that. We want to take care of you. But the policy has to be right, I'm saying. If the policy is not right for a financial institution, it will not take off. It will, something the government has to give a support, a boost to the entrepreneurs. Which means you have an organization to take care of your problems. You have a government who is willing to listen to your ideas. You have a government who is willing to support you. You have a government who is willing to do your, study your marketing. You have a government who is going to listen to your problems. If you don't have this, I think fund is available. Lodhen can give you, we can give, maybe others also can give. But in the end, what success rate would be very low. So what I'm trying to say is something at a broad level, the government has to come up with the, to encourage you to set up businesses, something which is, it is not that difficult. But I think government also needs to, you know, listen to the entrepreneurs. Government needs to set up organizations who will listen to your problems. If today you go to Prime Minister or you go to Minister one by one, it's not going to make any, how many of you can penetrate into their doors? But if you have a policy, government gives the policy, there are venture capitalists even from outsiders. You know, there are people who are willing to give. There are people who comes here every year to find out if, you know, whether they can assist the entrepreneurs here. They will put into venture capital in Bhutan. But our policy is not clear. If you are, you know, you set up a business venture, and then on you, a foreigner comes in, invest money in your thing today, and you know, if you don't utilize this fund properly and misuse the fund, where will you go? What is the course of action? What is the, you know, the legislation, the regulation? As a venture capitalist, I will come to you, I will invest my money, I will give you, say, okay, 5-6 years time, within 5-6 years time, I'll give you my money is this much. In 5 years time, you have an option of, you know, the paying me back with interest so much. And after 5 years, if you cannot pay back, then I have an option of taking back your firm and selling it to somebody else. So I have to have the option, no, as a financier. Today we don't have this. But if the regulations are right, somebody, there is a, you know, organization to take care of your problems.
Thank you, Tashu.
It will be done, I'm saying. You know, financial, the funding is not going to be a problem. But a major problem is the organizational structure is not in place. Okay.
Thank you, Tashu.
Thank you so much. So with this, let me ask Tarchin. Dasho was mentioning that while the banks are interested in coming up with the appropriate schemes to support young entrepreneurs to build a vibrant entrepreneurial ecosystem in the country, the structure has to be right. As an entrepreneur, what do you think we should do in order to influence the policy?
I'm more than happy to be here on the panel because we could get the real information in terms of policy at the financial institution level. Before I really question, answer your question, I would like to make this wild assumption, you know, and throw the question back to the floor, say, you know, what if the policy doesn't come out? Just imagine. Because there are so much of possibilities and opportunities that will give us, if whatever Dasho is proposing, like if these things are going to happen, the rules and regulations and all the policy are going to happen if in line towards the policy that we aspire, that we want. And if like the government listen to us, if government is willing to listen to us and set up this kind of facility or put this kind of policy in place, but what if these things don't come? What will you do as an entrepreneur? What are the risks that you are going to take, you know, in order to really go ahead? Because as a person, you cannot wait this policy to come in place. Yeah, by that time, who knows, like some of us may already become 40 or 25 or 30, you know. And these are the wild assumptions, and this is a real business plan. And to just to answer Sir Doji's question, but what I feel is like, as much as we aspire some changes, especially in this kind of things, I feel like all the stakeholders combined together, we have to play the role. As an entrepreneur, as a young people, our aim of becoming an entrepreneur should not be because you are unemployed. our aim and objective of being or becoming an entrepreneur should be larger than just being in Brighton. Nobody will buy that idea. Come on. More the idea, no one will buy the idea. Like if I go to Dutch Crypto and I say like, I want to set up this office because I want to create employment. Because I don't think in that way. Because as a person, I look at, you know, profitability, sustainability, and the you as a person who is coming to me. So what I'm going to ask is like, as a young people, we have to have this spirit, more a culture, whereby like if you are really able to convince your friends and community, and you know these things are possible because you are doing it. Because not you are not asking it people to do it for you, but you are doing it and then proving. So generally on the other side, the government is going to see more, no? Whether it is a right move to invest for the financial institution, whether it is right move, right to invest or not. So on that way, we have to go more. No? Just being idle and complaining and then asking things to fall for you, I think it would be very naive, say, no? So we have to both go both the ways. No? But as an entrepreneur, I would like to, it's a heartfelt question that I feel as a young startup and as a company that we are just now running just now, what I really feel is like being financial or being an NGO or as a person at an individual level, I think we should a little bit going beyond say no matter, because at the end of the day, it's not all about money and business. Because what I feel is like if the financial institutions are really doing well, for me as a person, like this is my very naive suggestion, the opinion. There's nothing wrong in investing around 2% of the total income is there, and what about putting this money on the forum for the public, for the young people to take up? Because at the end of the day, like we are going to be the potential clients for the business. This is what I feel that maybe that small step, because Loden, we say like a charity organization is being very difficult, because now let's say like if Loden has to take this burden of, you know, taking the risks. But at the end of the day, Loden has to also sustain his office, like the fund we collect, because Gerard might be working very hard at the international forum to collect the money, and Dr. Pramfinzo and Sir Doji, you know, being able to. So I don't feel a little bit correct on the very human level. So that's what I have to say. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Picking up on the point that Tashra Kutu has mentioned about the non-performing loan, Gerard, as in his capacity as a co-founder of Loden Entrepreneurship Program, he has been involved since the inception of this program in 2008, and we have been financing at least a dozen projects every year. And this year, we have financed 21 projects. So, Gerard, in your experience, 24. Sorry. Thank you for the correction. In your experience of the last 8 years, you must have come across projects. You know, non-performing projects, and some, you know, were not able to really exceed in their businesses. So, what inspired you to start, you know, launch this project in Bhutan, the entrepreneurship program, and also what has been your experience? You must come with this non-performing launch. What do you think are the reasons that they were not able to pay you back?
Yes, thank you, Dobby. When we started the Loden Entrepreneurship Program, most of my friends thought that I was becoming a little mad. And when I say that, I'm not mentioning just my European friends, but before launching it, I went to visit Bhutan because I had a conversation with Karma explaining what we wanted to do, but Karma very nicely said that he had no strong personal view on that because he was in academia. So, you know, financing entrepreneur, maybe not. So I came to Bhutan, I remember very well, for 2 weeks. I tried to interview a number of people at different level, trying to explain what was my idea. And the reception, to be frank, was not hostile, but was not that encouraging. Basically, people said it has never been tried, or when it was tried, as Dasho said, the non-performing loan were 60%, 70%, so are you willing to lose 70% of your money? Then they said, you will not find entrepreneurs. because there are very few, you know, maybe 10, 20, and you will not receive business plans. And I remember very well asking Doji, who was already with us almost every week, a little before, are we receiving business plans? And Doji said, don't worry, Charles, we are receiving business plans. And one day, maybe I was in a slight bad mood, and I said, Doji, are we receiving business plans? Because all my life, I've been in venture capital, and you know, business plans don't grow on trees. You have to go and find the business plan. And he said, don't worry, Charles, don't worry. So when he called me at the end of August, telling me we have 72 business plans, wow, I could not believe it. Then I said, send the business plan. And I thought I would receive, you know, really very, very bad. And I was very positively surprised. Yes, there were some very, very bad business plans. But there were some good business plans. And the proof is that we, in this year, we have selected 7, which I must say, on the whole, have done pretty well. I don't think we have any non-performing on the first year. I don't think we have any. So, just to say that, yes, in Bhutan, we have found a field which has been quite successful. And as Dasho knows, because he sits on the board of London, happily, our non-performing loans are relatively small. I would say 20% in this range, which is much better than any figures that he mentioned. Why? Because we are a competition. Somebody who sent a business plan to London had one chance out of 10 to be selected. So obviously, we are not that smart, and sometimes we do mistakes, but obviously we take what we say in French, la crème de la crème, you know, the top in those sectors. This is why, it's not because we are genius, but it just, by selection, obviously, you improve enormously your rate of success. But I'm often asked by some people, can you extend it a lot? Can you move from 24 projects to 240 projects? If we do that, our non-performing loans will jump enormously. So this is a comment on non-performing loans. But I would like, because Dasho mentioned that, maybe say a few words about the venture capital fund. It has been my job for 30 years. So I've been asked many times, and we are also within the audience, just like me, many times I've been approached saying, what do you think about a venture capital fund in Bhutan? And I must say personally, I said, too early. Until now, I've changed my mind. I think the timing now is right. It's maybe still early, but it was early in France when we started in 1984, I can tell you. But I think the timing is right. Why? Because clearly there are more entrepreneurs. And I think a venture capital firm, probably several, because to create an ecosystem you need to have several, not just one. Several venture capital firms in Bhutan could do well. There are, but with a number of conditions. This is what I try to say. You have many types of venture capital firms now. But the two, I think, which would be appropriate for Bhutan are an organization which could be funded by the financial institution together on the model of a firm in London which was quite successful called 3i. 3i was started 20 years ago, or maybe 25 years ago, by the UK government at the time, who basically said, we need a venture capital firm in the UK, and we need it not to be just in London, but to be all over the UK. And we call all the financial institutions of the UK and you say, you pay, you put the money. And 3i has been, globally a big success. It has, as I was saying, ups and downs, but it has certainly put the culture of venture capital in the society in the UK. Sreal now has many, many competitors, but Sreal has played a major role. So I could see that from that. But there is another type of venture capital fund which could also have some success in Bhutan, which is based not on the money of financial institutions, but on the money of wealthy Bhutanese citizens. And in my previous job, I started personally in London a firm just like that. It was called a venture capital trust, and I've raised money at the level of, you know, it was very, very small compared to Sreal, and we were totally minuscule. But I've raised money from 3,600 UK citizens. And they were not the millionaires, they were, I would say, the upper middle class in the UK. And they were not in London. I don't think I had any London investor, by the way. They were all from relatively, not the most, you know, central place in the UK. And they were quite old. On average, these 3,600 people had an average age of 60. And 80% of them were women, because the women live longer. And the women have more money than the men. So I was raising money from all British ladies with my strong French accent, so you can see the challenge. But we made it. Why people invested in our firm? And they invested a relatively small amount of money, you know, maybe a month or 2 months of annual of their revenue.
Two more minutes.
Yeah, no, I finish. I just finished my story. So why they were giving us the money? They were giving us the money because they had a strong tax advantage. Each time they were giving us £100, they could take from their tax bill £40. Which means that the real cost for them was 60% of their investment. And despite that, I must say, we were not that successful with their money. My message on that is just to say that if you want, if the government, the financial institution and all that, want to attract the money from wealthy Bhutanese, they need to put in place a very significant tax advantage scheme. It's done all over the world, it's on average 35%. Because if you don't do that, the people will lose their money, and if they lose their money, they will not subscribe again.